yesterday. So typical Manny fashion. You guys know me. I'm very I don't sometimes I don't think I'm so involved with work that I kind of just forget the outside. I didn't forget at all. Adding a third dog, definitely not adding a third dog. These two are way more than enough already. But yesterday, finally, after a really, really long time, dude, like way, way too long. I'm officially a married man. Really long time, man. Long time in the works. Kathy and I yesterday tied the knot. It was. So for a hashtag Corona wedding or whatever. I don't know, dude. I don't know how that's gonna be called now. I have no idea. It was forever in the making. We had it for Vegas in March. Coronavirus happened. And then finally yesterday we had, it was our own little, small little thing. We just kind of went to the courthouse and did it ourselves. And dude, man, it was tough because stuff like this isn't easy. And then I see like, oh, Corona, the whole joke about coronavirus. And I was like, well, one day I'll be able to tell my kids, yo, coronavirus wedding, dude. So here, because I never really show her on stream or social media or anything, but I do have a picture yesterday. Here you go. That was us yesterday. All right, so let's go. What you will see here is your or at least my FC screen. So if you guys want to follow along and if you guys want to do some of this, again, you guys can implement whatever you guys want, but I'm going to go to the 7/24/2019 slate. You guys want to follow along, I am on lineup rewind. It is a brand new clear slate. Just clear absolutely everything. Clear everything. Clear, 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 clear. And this is what it should look like. All right, let's go. Talking about projections first before I get into the settings, okay? Forget what's on the screen right now. That's just what I had from last year. Projections go as follows for me, okay? For me, at least for MLB, projections aren't the end-all be-all, right? Something like an 11.3, I don't know what the average for everyone would be, but like if some of you had 11, some of you had 10.8, I had 11.3, some have 11.8, some have 11.75, it's really, really close to the same, right? And when you're talking MLB, when there's a lot of people who fail on a given day, half a point or a third of a point or a quarter of a point isn't the end all be all. I'd even go a step further and say how you project hitters relative to their team, because if you project, I don't know, your Mathis at something that he's not supposed to be, a point or two higher, that's going to drastically change your exposure to Mathis when you're stacking his team, right? So kind of just relative to the team, how are you projecting players? More importantly, projections aren't the end-all be-all for either of the two sports that are really similar. This one or NHL would be my opinion. To settings, which I think is where we start getting... here's where the questions start arising. So I'm going to go one by one. And again, if you have any questions, feel free to leave them in the chat. I'll address them as we go by. You guys know from prior streams, my uniques. All it is how many unique players are going to be from lineup to lineup. You have the perfect lineup as your lineup number one. Your next lineup has to have at least one player different, has to have at least two players different, has to have at least three players different, four. You can put as many as you want, right? For me, my recommendation would be three. To be honest, and I will say this, uniques, especially in MLB, you can get away with even having one, two. You can have as least as you want. I'll explain to you why. For the most part, and you'll see when we get farther along into the process, we use a lot of stacks in our 150, in our 100, in our 20, however many lineups you run, you should be running multiple stacks. you should be capping hitters in some way, shape, or form. Naturally, if I make five Colorado stacks and then make five Washington stacks, there's going to be more than just two or three unique players anyway. The only reason this would matter too much is how many different players from the same stacks will you have, whether that's pitchers or fillers, right? So if I'm stacking Colorado, one player different could mean a different filler than normal. And even then, you could argue that this isn't all that important either, because if you're double stacking, say using a five-man Colorado stack and a two-man Washington stack, you should be capping the small stacks as well and differentiating, right? Saying out of the five Colorado stacks you have, one should be Washington two-mans, the other one should be Philly two-mans, the other one should be Cincinnati two-mans. And again, just by using different two-mans and or different double stacks, you should have more than one unique player there as well too, right? Minimum salary, I almost never use, at least not in MLB, only because some teams are really expensive, some teams are really cheap, and using minimum, depending what your minimum salary is, you can skew your numbers just a tad. The example would be recent memory, like Boston is always expensive when where you wanted Benintendi, Mookie, JD, whoever. And you could only, if I had a minimum salary, I'd get a ton of them. But then if I wanted minimum, if I had a minimum salary and I wanted to play the Marlins, very tough to get the Marlins without just slamming in more Boston next to them to fill in the salary cap, right? Hitter versus pitcher. By the way, if you hover over every little information little bubble, you'll see what that little tab means. Hitter versus pitcher is very easy. How many hitters maximum can you have against your pitcher? By default, this is set to zero. You want to leave this at zero because if you play Max Scherzer, you don't want anyone against him. Essentially, if Max Scherzer strikes him out, that means the batter is getting 0 points for that at bat. If the batter hits a home run, vice versa, right? Max Scherzer will get negative. So they kind of cancel each other out. The only time I do use hitter versus pitcher is when it's a small slate. Showdown, by default, you're going to use this. But even two games, three games, I think you have to, only because you want to get unique. You want to be different from the field. Playing one, maybe two hitters, depending how small the slate is, like the two-gamer that's coming up to start the season, you might want to use maybe one or even two max hitters against your pitcher. All this is saying is the number of hitters that can be facing the opposing pitcher, right? Global exposure setting. Again, I'll just leave this hovered every time I explain it, right? This is kind of the and this is where it starts getting tricky. We talked about this last week as to why you should be using each. I think groups or what used to be our each or group, right? Used to be for us, it's based on total number of lineups. So, for example, I want to cap someone at 10%. If I were to use each, it'll use them once and then won't use them next time. And it's like a running percentage count of how much you're using a player. That way it can never go over 10% and is evenly distributed throughout the entire 150, 100, 50, 20, whatever you're making, right? If you use based on number of lineups created, if I have someone capped at 10%, it can use them and I'm making 100 lineups, it could use them in the first 10 lineups and never use them again, right? All top players use each. So just use each. It's much better. Here's a simple way to cap all players. If you wanted to cap, for example, you see everyone's exposure here on the right side is at 100%, meaning I could use anyone 100% if I wanted to. If you wanted to change everyone at one time, you could do 50%, change all players, and everyone would be changed to 50, including the pitchers. But if you wanted to change only hitters, you would go to the hitters tab, go to exposure, change it back to 100, apply to players. That would change everyone, every hitter to 100. Pitchers will stay at 50, right? Where do I start with randomness? I feel like randomness has been a topic of conversation for the longest time in how we use it, how it's calculated, why we should use it, what it does, why. To be honest, I don't think there's a right way to use this. It all depends on your level of risk, how much risk you want to assume, or if you want to differentiate a ton. I think there might be better ways of using randomness than what people currently do. All randomness is, and again, I'll just keep hovering over this. It technically randomizes projections just a tad. So the classic randomness, the top randomness, used to be where if someone was projected at 10 points, let's say Mookie Betts for this example is projected at 10 points, and I have him at 10% randomness, every time FC makes a lineup, just one lineup, it has to calculate a projection for Mookie. That projection is done by getting a random number between 10% less of his projection and 10% more of his projection, meaning pick a random number between 9 and 11. It's going to pick at random. It's going to pick 9.3, and that's Mookie projections for that individual lineup. If it uses him and if he comes out in the lineup, if it's optimal, it will use him there. If not, it won't. And the very next lineup, if you're running 150, that's lineup number one. Lineup number two will do the same process for Mookie, right? Maybe it'll use 10.87 this time and be on the opposite end of his spectrum. It'll definitely use him there because I assume he's a great value, yada, 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 right? There is a randomness demo that Dave is dropping in the chat, by the way. I think this is a better way of me explaining the normal distribution randomness, right? This is how randomness works in a nutshell, where this is the classic randomness. It'll choose randomly. The projection is 50. Randomness is 20%. I have 150 lineups. Each bar here is one lineup, right? It's just going to randomly choose in between 60 and 40, right? It's 10 points less than 50, 10 points more than 50. That's the range. It's going to randomly choose in the middle. And if I were to do this again, it could be completely random. And again, and again, and again, and again, and again, and again. It's just going to be completely random. The other form of randomness that we have that came out with FC Pro last year is the normal distribution randomness, right? And this is the randomness that says we're still going to pick between a range, right? It'll still be between 40 and 60, right? But it's going to use a normal distribution, meaning it's going to use more instances that are closer to the mean, closer to 50, than it is just the tail end of the spectrum for both sides, right? It's going to use more that are closer in the middle. Essentially, that's what randomness should be. Randomness should never be like, Mookie, I have him projected at 10. I'm going to put 10% randomness. Let me use 9.1 10 times. It could possibly happen. You never know. It's random. This will keep it in line to where the projection still has a ton of weight and it's still going to hover around the main projection. And we feel, with our studies, with our back testing, with how we've seen randomness play out, we feel normal distribution is a much better representation of how randomness should work. We don't want it to be just literally completely random. Now think about this for a second. Why I say this is because if you have not just Mookie with randomness, if you have your entire player pool with 20% randomness and you're using this randomness, your projections can get pretty skewed. And you could have some lopsided lineups. And in turn, you could have some pretty poor lineups that project poorly. If everyone was this random from 40 to 60, It'd be pretty tough. And you have 300 players, it'd be pretty tough, right? Now you go a step further and do this for pitchers as well, you're gonna start getting some weird lineups, right? That's the difference between both. I personally use the normal distribution randomness. If you do want to use classic and you do want to have just completely random numbers in between for absolutely everyone in your pool, I'd suggest using randomness that's, I don't know, 5% or something very minimal to where you're just fluctuating between, I don't know, you know? It's use something really small if you're using classic. If not, use normal distribution. That's what I use when I use randomness. Again, if you are capping a ton, if you're capping stacks, if you're capping player exposures, if you're capping pitching exposures, then you could even do this with no randomness. You don't need randomness. It's for people that want more diversity, right? Stacks. So stacks usually go like this. It's never in the position stacks tab. That used to be when we didn't have this tab. This tab is how you used to make stacks in the old days, at least for the next few days, we'll continue using this. So for the sake of this example, I'll briefly go over stacks on this, and then I'll go over stacks on what we will be using this season. Groups and my data, we haven't gone over yet. There's nothing here. I don't use groups for MLB at all. So you won't get this tab from me, at least not today. Team stacks. This is how you normally make a stack, right? So we've talked about, okay, so let me answer a few of the basic questions of stacking. What is stacking? Just play multiple players from one team. Why would you stack? This is a very random sport when you have an outlier game, at least per slate. Team that scores 6, 7, 8 runs. There's a lot of correlations between the players on the teams. A run, an RBI, a home run drives them all in. You get into the bullpen, all those guys also face the bullpen. It's just the ultimate correlation sport, right? Real quick, this is how you used to make stacks. You're going to continue making stacks for the next few days. You would add one stack. In this case, we'll make a 5-man stack. From this drop down, you just click flat 5. Count pitcher as part of a stack? Never. Can't really do that. Well, you can, but never. You would add every team. And right here, all this is saying is, every lineup I make has to have at least 5 hitters from the same team. They could be any batting order, 1 through 9. All teams are eligible to fall in, and I can play one team as much as I get him. If my projections love the Rockies more than anything, and it wants to play 150 Rockies, it can, because I have them at 100%. But if I want to cap, and I want to say I don't want to use any team more than 20%, it won't use them more than 20%. And then when you make your lineups, it'll look something like this, right? It'll use 5 players at a minimum from every team. Romuto, Hoskins, this is last year. Romuto, Hoskins, Caesar, Hazley, and Williams, that's 5. And then the 3 are just random. And as you go down, you'll see that I use some Texas, I use some Milwaukee, I use some Giants, so on and so forth all the way down. But every lineup has to have at least 5 people from the same team, right? That's all that stack means. If I wanted to add a second stack, I would also alongside add a second one. This could be 2 or 3 players because you can't do any more. You already have a 5 on one side. I'll leave this at 2 players for this example. I'm also not going to count the pitcher. It can use anyone from the 1 through 9. I will highlight all teams so all can be eligible. This time I don't want to use any mini stack more than, I don't know, let's say 10%, right? And I'll do it this way. If you, again, want to see what your stacks look like, we've done this here on the left side where you can see the exact exposure to each team you have. 5-player stacks, we have 3 Milwaukee, 3 Giants, 3 Texas. 6-player stacks you're only getting when I have a 5-man Philly stack and I'm also using the pitcher. That's why you're getting these 6s, right? Corbin and Washington is why I have a 6 of Washington, but those are also 3 technically. And then if you want to see combos, how much Washington and Philly together do I have? That would be 2. You have 1 of everything else that's going down, right? I don't think I've ever done this, but let's go over my... You could use 3-3-2, but that really isn't... That's not enough correlation for me, at least not in tournaments, right? I've never really gone over, like... I don't know what you would call this. My power rankings for stacks. What stack I think is the best? What stack I think is the worst? I've played MLB DFS from the days where you could stack 6, so I've seen quite a bit. I've seen where we used to stack 6 pretty much every single day, just one team almost. My power rankings, let's do this. Why not? My power rankings for stacks are, and I'll go from best to worst, and I'll just include 5s and 4s. That's 5-3, 5-2, 5-naked, and then 4-4, 4-3. Can we do that? My power rankings go as follows. And these two are really, really... How do I want to put this? I want to say for large field tournaments, right? For large field tournaments, I think 5-3s are really, really good. I think they might be the best, in my opinion. 5-3s. I really do think it's a tie between 5-2s and naked 5s. Meaning 5 players from one team, 2 from... The last two spots, I think 4-4s and then 4-3s. Create new stack, very simple. This is how we did it in the old stack tab, right? This is where it starts looking a little bit different. So the reason we have all of this, and if you are following this week, there's still some stuff you haven't seen yet, so I'll explain everything you see on the screen right now. In order to add one stack, a stack, any stack, it's almost the same, right? I add one stack. This currently says four players, but I want to switch this. This is where the tab is now. I want to switch it to five players. Again, this is saying, if you even want to hover over this, at a minimum of five batters per whatever team. You can change the same way we change everyone's exposure to 20%. You can do it right here. Same thing. And again, if you hover over this, you'll see it. I'm going to leave this at 100 for now. Max gap is the change this year that we have to the stacking part, right? Where if you read it, use the max gap settings to restrict baseball hitting stacks and minimize the missing players in the allowed stacks. If the max gap is set to two players, that will allow up to two missing players in the stack. And then we give you an example. Batting orders 1, 2, 5, 6 or 1, 2, 4, 6 would both be valid stacks with two player gaps. And you see it because in the first example, it skips 3 and 4. Then you have 5, 6 right after. In the second example, it skips 3 and it skips 5. Those are still two gaps, right? This will also use wraparound stacks, meaning 9, 1, 2, 3 has a gap of 0. Why we did this was we want you to have, and this is what we were lacking in the old stacking way, is the customization to be able to filter out stacks the way you want to. So let's say, and because, believe it or not, when we went back in lineup study throughout the year and studied multiple tournaments, multiple players, hundreds and thousands of lineups, we figured out that there's a lot of wasted lineups in MLB. Meaning, sometimes I would have a four-player stack of 2, 4, 6, 8 as my stacks, right? That defeats the purpose of a stack because essentially you want guys that correlate with each other. Now, can the 2 and the 8 correlate with each other if it gets to the 9, goes to the 1, and come back around? Sure. But then is the 8 correlated with the 4? Like, how is it all like, you're missing the point of correlation, right? And naturally thinking, the highest correlated lineups would probably be one where there's no gaps in between the players, right? Where your player gets on, the very next player is also in your stack. He gets on, the very next player is also in your stack. He gets a home run, the very next player's, and that way, right? Now, if you guys have too many gaps in between, it takes away from what a stack should be, right? And you have a lot less correlation. So you technically still stacked Colorado. You just have players coming up, you know, nowhere near next to each other, which defeats the purpose. If I were to set max gaps to 1, first of all, if I just leave it at any, you see that there's 56 total stacks of Colorado, a 5-man Colorado that you can do. If I wanted one player gap, it'll filter and you see how many stacks are left, right? There's only 20 one player gap stacks. If I were to go to 2 and it just keeps changing and changing and changing and changing with whatever your settings are. This number isn't the same for every team, naturally, because some teams on some days will have two players playing the same position. And you can't. You can't do that. Can't do that. Another cool thing we added, and this is recent, none of you guys have seen this yet, are all these green and red numbers. So for 5-man stacks, in this case, you'll see what the, and if you hover over it, you'll see the highest projected Colorado stack, or highest projected 5-man stack, is 40.17. 31.69 is the lowest. And just like that, you can see every column. First of all, let me show you how to stack a second team. If you wanted to stack a second team, you'd just click the second version. You would click this window. You can click between windows, see how they highlight for you. I would then go to 3 if I wanted it to be 3, or 2 if I wanted it to be 2. And right here, you have a 5-2 stack. Similar to the team stacks tab, every lineup you make after this will have to have 5 players from one team, 2 players from the other team. The other cool part, which is I think Dave's favorite part about the whole thing, is if I were to actually click on a team, and sorry, let me click on the five man. If I were to click on a team and I have it at set to five players, not only do I see all players and I can uncheck which player I want in my five man, and you see how the numbers keep changing. You can kind of sort through whatever you want. If you don't want any black men at all, and you just wanted everyone else but black men, it'll show you all the stacks. There's 21 stacks that are all five men that have any gap, it doesn't matter, that don't include black men in here, right? But I think his favorite part is, if you talk to Dave about this, he'll talk to you about this feature forever. And it is true. It's amazing. It's amazing. If you go to the stacks tab, it'll actually show you every possible stack that meets your criteria, right? So five mans, let's say I had it at one player, you'll see every possible Colorado stack, and there's only 20 of them, right? But you'll see them here, and you'll see exactly what they are. These are the five man stacks here. Now, if I wasn't a fan and I wanted to sort by projection, if I wasn't a fan of these bottom ones down here, I don't want to use those ever. So I'm going to uncheck those. I could only use the top projected five man stacks for Colorado. The possibilities are endless. That in a nutshell is what we have here. Manny, what do you play as far as stacks? What are your lineups looking at like? Okay, so I'm going to delete everything we have now. Manny, what do you use? What are you using in 2020? You're making lineups for Thursday. What are you doing? Okay, create new stack. I already told you my power rankings for stacks. I use fives. I do cap, depending on the slate, depending how many teams are playing, depending how many games. I think 15. This seems too complex for old school dudes like myself. You don't have to use it. You don't have to use anything. You don't have to use nothing. You don't have to use absolutely nothing. You could use just make lineups and that's it. I will do five man stacks. I think 15-ish. I think this will vary from slate to slate, but for the sake of this example, I think around 50. Anything more than this, I think it might be too much. And I even want to emphasize teams that are not the highest owned on the slate. So like, let's say Colorado, for the sake of this example, is playing in Coors or something, and they're the highest owned team by far, even though we've known from studying that even the highest owned teams aren't that high owned. I think I might want to either play them a lot less in the field, or even not play them at all on really big slates. I, since I was the one that asked for this, choose to do one player gap. You can do two player gaps if you want to. Manny Lora likes one. I include everyone. I include absolutely everyone. And this will be my... I will use five mans. And a combination of five threes and naked fives. That's my answer. So this will be one way. The other way, I would add a second round. I'll do a second stack. I'll do threes. And then cap that to where I could only get maybe one mini per five-man stack. So, like, I only want one Washington with Colorado, one Philly with Colorado, one Detroit with Colorado, and it'll be... projections will take over at that point. You understand what I'm saying? I would cap that. I don't know what that is. Maybe 10% or so. Again, depending on how many games and how many teams are on the slate. The last part of this process, and we could wrap it all up at the end or whatever, but is one that... how do I explain this one? It's definitely not misleading. It's definitely useful. How people are using it, I don't know exactly how people are using this, right? So I'm gonna delete all of this so you guys just don't get sidetracked. If you use, whether it's through FC Pro or Awesome or whatever, the ownership projections, right? Ownership projections are projections before the slate starts that show you, or at least try to predict, how owned each player will be, right? I think we've evolved the game, or at least... few people have. Definitely awesome with how he puts it out in front of everyone. Stacking ownership as well. How often a stack will be owned. And how I use it, because I feel this sport is so stack intensive. I like capping stacks more than anything. And if you're using double stacks, whatever you're capping your mini at is going to dictate how much of a player you're going to have anyway. So indirectly, you're kind of capping players in that sense. For me, again, my process, feel free to, this all depends on you guys. It's, I would love to look at stack ownership first. Say Colorado's going to be 10% owned today. Washington's going to be 8% owned today. And all the way down, you see a list of all stacks and how they're going to be owned. Let's say there's 16 teams. There's 8 games. There's 16 teams on the slate. You see from first to the very end. I, Manuel Lora, Manny Lora, likes kind of skipping or just going underweight on the first two teams and playing a significant amount of everyone else. A couple questions you might have. I do not play every single team. I do not want to play every single team. I think eventually law of diminishing returns if you diversify way too much. So I'm not trying to play the very last team all the way to the very first team. It also goes without saying, I don't want to completely fade the top two teams. I just like to play them a little bit less than the field, right? And the ones that I feel are a little bit lesser owned, I'd like to play more than the field. On a given day, if there are 7 games, 14 teams, I'd love it if I could get to 10 teams, right? With my highest owned team not being the tournament's highest owned team. And I like to diversify that way, right? I'd like to cap stacks at 15%. I don't like running stacks more than 15%. If anything, I'd love to get even my highest stack less than that. I'd also like to cap players if you are running fillers. If you're running 5 naked and it's just randomly going to give you players in there, capping players also, at least in my opinion, is imperative. How I do this here too. If you go back and here's, by the way, here's where I'm coming up with all these numbers. I'm not just randomly thinking in my head, right? I first started out with randomly doing some calculations myself and seeing how much I wanted to cap players and stacks at, number one. Number two is we have thousands of lineups studied on this channel. All the way from casual players, Millie Maker winners, to last placers, to mine, to Bricks, to Alex's, to everyone's line. We've studied the entire DFS industry. And I think collectively we've come together and made a pretty decent assumption. It's obviously not perfect. That even players, when you cap players, Anthony Rendon, he's not on Washington anymore, but Anthony Rendon, if you want to cap everyone, a max of 30 seems like a really good baseline. If you want a little bit less, sure. If you want a little bit more, that's fine too. Seems like a perfect spot, right? I at least from what we've seen in all the lineups that we've covered over the last years. Pretty simple, right? MLB is a fail sport. I don't know. And again, this depends on how much you want to risk as a person. Wakey Wakey's probably someone that'll play Trey Turner 65% with not a care in the world. That's just his style. He likes playing. He likes putting his eggs in one basket, maybe two. That's just how he plays. If you are one that likes diversifying more, consider lowering that number. It all depends on your risk tolerance. There isn't a set number here. Same goes for pitchers. And this is one we don't cover often here, but pitching as well too. Exposures for pitchers, and although here's probably a misconception too. Although pitchers are more projectable when you're making the comparison between pitchers and hitters, you can still cap your pitchers, right? And there's a reason for this. Not because I don't want, 65% of Patrick Corbin. But if I do put 65% of Patrick Corbin, every single stack that I make when I'm making them individually will have about 50 to 65% of Patrick Corbin. And Patrick Corbin's great, fantastic. But if I have, say, 1-5 stacked with Patrick Corbin, I would hate to have, again, 1-5 stacked with Patrick Corbin just mixing up the hit, mixing up the fillers. I would love to mix up Patrick Corbin as well. I don't want the same pitching combination for the majority of my lineups, right? I would hate that. So capping pitchers as well too, from what I've seen, from what we've seen, anywhere from 40 to 50 seems like a good baseline. Again, depending on your risk tolerance, a little bit less is fine, a little bit more is fine. So caps here, and caps here for me. My data is interesting, and this is the last one that I will, the last tab that I really use, if I use. This is, and this is, if you have, if you're not familiar with the My Data tab, this is where you can upload your own column with statistics, right? Well, use the column with statistics. So when I upload, when you upload something and I want to create, instead of WOBA, let's do BOBA. And I create Manny Lora with a BOBA of 5. Then I could go to the My Data tab and use my BOBA for whatever reason, right? Right? I would go refresh, and then you could use it. But I don't. It's not that I don't recommend. It's there are those type of guys that have, you know, those type of people that upload like a full-on Excel sheet and start doing like some massive calculations on FC. Like, there's been people in here that say in the Discord that are like, dude, I uploaded BOBA, BOBA plus, weighted BOBA average. And I was just like, what are you doing, dude? There's no need to add every single thing. Like, for example, DC's new make-believe site is going to have some ridiculous statistics. He's going to come up with DC weighted average, movement weighted, whatever the heck he's talking about. And everyone's going to add like 3 of those things in here. I don't know for what reason. And then allow a minimum of... And then... Manny... I keep getting an error in my crunches. What's going on? I mean, it's like, trust me, I only have one unique. I didn't even set a minimum salary, I promise. So what the heck are you uploading with a minimum of 5 boba points? Of course you're not getting anything, dude. You have a big fettuccine of statistics in here. What are you doing? Like, I don't understand. And then... All they told me, dude, I just have one unique. I didn't even add a stack. No, you didn't add anything. Don't worry. You don't really need much. The only way I would recommend using something like this is if you're using some sort of randomness. And remember, I said I was going to comment on this earlier in the stream. If you're using some type of randomness and you want to limit your bad lineups, you can use your My Projection and allow a minimum of, I don't know, if you see your average projection is 150 and you wanted to do 120 at a minimum, you don't want anything below 120, you can use something like this. And even with randomness, it'll help keep your lineups have a minimum of 120 projections, keeping the bad ones from populating, right? And so Abyssal, wherever you are, that you use 3,000 randomness, use 3,000 randomness and put a strict limit on what the minimum of a lineup projection can look like. But even then, you shouldn't be needing to use this. Very few circumstances where you need to use this. Say Alex, maybe in the way he populates a lot of lineups, maybe wants to use this. But if this is what you're going to upload with, probably not. That's it. That's our MLB process, man. My lineups? I think they're already in, boys. I think they're already... I don't even need lineups. I think they're already in, man. I think we're good. I think we're ready to rock, man. The only thing that changes... It's just slate size. That's it. 2 gamers. 10 gamers.